Thank you. I had some audio issues with AMBAG.
Great. Welcome, everyone, to our Wednesday, November 10th, 2021, Capitola City Council meeting. I'm so used to coming out of closed session on one of these, but we are going to start as normal with Chloe saying a few words.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. Hello and welcome to the Capitola City Council meeting. In accordance with California Senate Bill 361, this meeting is not physically open to the public. Council and staff are meeting via Zoom, and there are several ways for the public to watch and participate. Information on how to join the meeting using Zoom, or a landline mobile phone, along with how to submit public comment during the meeting tonight, is available on our website, cityofcapitola.org, and on the published meeting agenda. The public can also live stream the meeting on our website. As always, the meeting is cablecast live on Charter Communications Cable TV Channel 8 and is being recorded to be rebroadcast on the following Wednesday at 8 a.m. and on Saturday following the first rebroadcast at 1 p.m. on Charter Channel 71 and Comcast Channel 25. Our technician tonight is Walter. Thank you, Walter, and thank you, Mayor Brooks.
Thank you so much, Chloe. Chloe, I couldn't hear. Did you go ahead and do a roll call, please?
I will do that now.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. Councilmember Bertrand.
Present.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Here.
Councilmember Peterson.
Present.
Vice Mayor Story.
Here.
And Mayor Brooks.
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Chloe. As you can see, you can't see me, and my computer's acting up. This is going to be the most bizarre meeting. I'm talking to a blank screen, and it's weird, folks. But I'm imagining there's council there, and there's Gail somewhere in the crowd who's going to be our guest later on. So hello to everyone. If you can please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you so much. We're now going to move on to item 2 for our presentation, and we're going to begin with our proclamation honoring retiring Police Chief Terry McManus, and I'm going to need some support. Jamie, is Terry with us?
Yes, he is.
Lovely. Well, I had the honor of giving Chief McManus this wonderful, much-deserved proclamation earlier today. I just wanted to share a few words.
Unfortunately, it looks like we've lost Mayor Brooks.
Yeah, it looks like Mayor Brooks is offline right now. I'll attempt to fill in, and let's see if she comes back. Unfortunately, I don't have the proclamation in front of me to recognize our retiring police chief, Chief McManus. We did have a special event for him this afternoon at the Shadowbrook, which was well attended by many of the other chiefs in our county, as well as the Capitola Police Force and many staff from the city of Capitola. And there were numerous members of the community that were there to see him off in the next chapter of his life. And I don't know, Jamie, do you have available there the proclamation?
I do. Would you like me to give you a few highlights?
Yeah, maybe you could read out some of the highlights from the from it so that everyone in attendance can hear it as well.
I'd be happy to. All right. So this is the Mayor's Proclamation honoring our retiring Police Chief Terry McManus. And whereas Chief Terrence K. Terry, McManus began his law enforcement career with the City of San Diego in 1986 and rose to the prominent rank of Assistant Chief of Police, completing 30 years of public service in 2016. Whereas on December 1st, 2016, Chief McManus was appointed as Capitola's 9th Chief of Police. Whereas Chief McManus will officially retire on the 13th of this month after serving 5 years of outstanding and meritorious policing service to the residents of Capitola. And during his tenure as Chief of Police, Terry has been committed and outstanding leader who's excelled in hiring, promoting, developing, and training a competent, diverse workforce of sworn civilian employees and volunteers. Whereas as a result of Chief McManus's work with his department, the city has realized a reduction in overall crime by reintroducing our city neighborhood watch program for volunteers and policing, and his work has and strengthening the relationships with our local partners. Whereas the city recognizes Chief McManus for his leadership during the COVID-19 pandemic, Chief McManus made sound financial and procedural decisions that ensured the department and the community's safety, at the same time while maintaining a high level of policing service for the citizens of Capitola. Whereas Chief McManus has served the city of Capitola with the highest level of professionalism, integrity, and ethics. So then, now therefore, Mayor Brooks, Mayor of the City of Capitola, does hereby commend Terry McManus for 35 years of excellence and dedicated service. It is further recognized that Terry McManus has always represented the City of Capitola with the highest degree of professionalism. His contributions, past, present, and future, will always be greatly appreciated by council members, city staff, and most importantly, residents of the City of Capitola.
Right. Thank you, Jamie. And I think I would like to, as a resident of the city of Capitola, one of the things that makes Capitola special is our police force. And we have enjoyed the benefit of having great leadership through Chief McManus. As the leader of our police force, he has kept our community and as well as having us all feel that we can be safe in the community. And I don't know that there's any thing that's been more important to that, to a resident. And now as a council member, I would like to, on behalf of the residents of Capitola, thank him officially for his 5 years of service. In that role, I have always found him to be extremely professional, but at the same time, very approachable, very heartfelt, genuine, and sincere, and approached his work, you could tell, with a great deal of caring and compassion. So with that, I want to just now publicly thank you, Chief McManus. You're going to be missed, but I know you will always have a place here in Capitola, and we hope to see you around, in different capacities. So with that, I was wondering, do other council members, do they have some words for Chief McManus at this time? Yes, Councilwoman Peterson.
Thank you. I just want to say thank you so much, Chief McManus, for all of your service to our community. It's been an honor to work with you throughout the years and in the opportunities that I've had to speak with you about important issues related to our city. When we held a series of community meetings around racial justice and equity, and we were at every single one of them, and we had several follow-up conversations. I'm just so impressed with your leadership, and you will be very sorely missed, but I'm very excited for this next chapter for you. And in today's gathering for your retirement, you could just see the joy kind of radiating from you for what comes next in your life. And so as much as I feel selfishly that I would like to just make a motion that you cannot leave, I understand that there are great things ahead of you. And of course, with our incoming Chief Daly, there's great things ahead of us also. So just just in general, thank you so much for all of your service to our community. There's something that I heard the former mayor of Stockton say recently, and he said, there's a difference between wanting to be something and wanting to do something. And so I think that regardless of what you have been or will be, you will always be doing something in service to your community or your family or the people around you. And so I want to thank you for what you have done for our city, and I can only wait to see or hear about what you will do next. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman Peterson. I'll call on Councilwoman Tyson.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. Terry, I haven't really been able to work with you for a super long amount of time as far as the other council members go, but just knowing you and being able to come to you or even just see you in passing or out in the village is just always, like Sam said, you're super approachable, and it's something that I think not a lot of people can really see in an officer or a chief of police or something like that. So it's just a really nice quality, and it's what sort of stands for Capitola, I think. And you've really paved a nice road for Captain Daly to come through, and it has been a pleasure working with you, and I'm really excited for you to go on and do interesting, and we'll be missed.
Councilmember Trent.
Thank you very much, Vice Mayor. So we met earlier this week, and I think I said a lot of what I felt then, and so it's hard for me to elaborate, but I think one thing that needs to be stressed is you've given a great gift to the people of Capitola. You've left us with a police department that is excellent. You have done what it takes to instill a real high degree of spirit de corps, of professionalism, and a commitment that I haven't noticed before. And I think that's a wonderful gift that you did, and it's totally reflective of who you are. And those are my comments.
Thank you. Are there any others for that would like to make any comments? Seeing none, I'm going to turn the microphone over to you, Chief McManus, for your last words.
Vice Mayor Story, if I may.
Hi.
I made it.
All right. Well,
I would love to share some words as well before we turn this over to the chief, if that's all right with you, Vice Mayor.
Absolutely. Please.
Wonderful. You know, Terry, I know you heard this earlier, but there were a lot of people talking to you at earlier today, and I just wanted to share those words that I from earlier to everyone here today. So leadership comes in all forms, right, depending on the type of leader you are. And some are abrupt and mighty and able, and others are natural and confident. This type of leadership stems from experience and commitment in a form that is unhindered and kind. And that's the type of leader that I would describe you as, Terry. And we're so proud to have you as our chief. For the past several years, I have seen our organization prevail due to successful leadership of Chief McManus. Through his commitment, patience, and goodwill, we have successfully addressed crises such as the pandemic, the attack on our BIPOC community, and destruction of our neighboring communities due to the CZU fires. Chief McManus has stepped up in support of our ever-changing community, attending every council meeting, even the one tonight, supporting implicit bias training, helped raise the pride flag with our constituents, and reviewed police policies in the fight for equity. Chief McManus has managed to maintain his stride and support through it all, and our community has been so lucky to have him. His commitment to social justice, equity, Capitola, and the rest of our county is renowned. positive from today's event. And it has been an honor to stand side by side with him during his tenure. It truly has been a privilege knowing him, and I congratulate you, Terry, and I wish you the best on your new adventure. And from what I understand, we've passed the proclamation on, and that's never enough. Your wall is going to be full of all of these wonderful things and shadow drop boxes, is what you called them earlier. Congratulations. And now I'll turn it over to you.
Well, thank you very much, Mayor Brooks, Vice Mayor Story, and the entire council for your kind words tonight, and so meaningful to hear them tonight, and have heard some of those same words, you know, throughout my time, for many of you, in my 5 years here in Capitola. And I want to thank those who were able to attend, you know, in the middle of the day on Wednesday. It's tough to get away during the lunch hour for an event, but I was so fortunate to have many of you able to attend the event this afternoon in Shadowbrook and share some stories there and talk about a few things, and then provide me the chance to really share some of my own thoughts towards the end of that event. And I won't do the same here, it would take way too long, but I was really thankful to see everyone this afternoon, and thankful to be here tonight and to hear these kind words. So thanks to all of you. I can't imagine a more rewarding position for me to really enjoy for my last 5 years as a law enforcement officer here in California, 35 years total. And when, you know, when I competed for the spot, the police chief position back in 2016, I had a vision and a thought that there was something unique in Capitola that I wanted to be part of, but, you know, work and assignments and positions don't always guarantee that. And so I didn't enter into this challenge and this job as a police chief with any guarantees, except that I knew that the change that I was going to experience was going to be healthy for me, and hopefully healthy for everybody else, and very enjoyable for all. And so now, 5 years later, it goes by so quick. 5 years later, I can say with a whole lot of confidence that is how I feel tonight. I'm just thankful for the opportunity to be the police chief here in Capitola. I wish Chief Dally all the success in the world. I think he's a great selection. He's a great representative of the city, the police department, and the community. And of course, he and I will stay in contact as he gets acclimated in his new position. And it's been an absolute pleasure to serve as a police officer in our world in California, and really, and most importantly, with extreme sincerity for everybody, to serve the last 5 years here in Capitola. I couldn't have asked for a better opportunity. I couldn't have asked for a better community that really supports me, supports us, supports the city. And it's been so enjoyable, and so I've learned so much in working with our council, the various mayors over the time that I've been here, Mayor Brooks, yourself tonight, and the other mayors that have served, in the entire council, and all the work that we strive to achieve as a team. And sometimes we get credit as individuals, and that's deserving as well, but really the great work is accomplished by great teamwork. And so tonight, I'd love to share with council and with the public who might be listening that the teamwork really is a key ingredient in the police department to achieve our goals and to meet the expectations of the community here in Capitola and everywhere. They have lofty expectations of police officers, and they should. I touched on that a little bit this afternoon, and it's been you know, a passion of mine for 35 years, and so with a whole lot of emotions, a lot of joy, and a whole lot of pride for ourselves as the Capitola Police Department. I'm turning the chapter on my law enforcement career, and blessed to have retired here as a police chief in Capitola. And I thank everybody for all of their support along the way. And I wish all of you success going forward in your individual lives and your careers and your aspirations. And I wish great fortune for the city and for the police department. And then thanks as well to everyone, all the staff in the city. You know, a lot of that work gets done behind the scenes. And especially, as you mentioned, Mayor Brooks, during this last almost nearly 2 years of the pandemic, we as a staff and we as a city weren't willing to not do the work that needs to get done here in Capitola to keep the community safe, to keep the community happy. happy and keep pushing forward in what has been the most difficult of circumstances, at least for me and in my position as a police officer for 35 years. No one would have imagined that we would have been confronted with these challenges that still exist, but I'm really proud of how we work through all of those as a city, as the various departments, and most importantly as a community here in Capitola. So thank you very much for everything, for the proclamation. Mayor Brooks, thank you, and for your kind words, everyone's kind words, and I'll say goodnight for now. Thank you very much.
Thanks again, Chief McManus, and we wish you the best on your new adventures. Congratulations on your retirement. Oh my gosh, I want a huge applause for you. I wish everyone could be there cheering you on. You know we are. You know we are. There it is. There it is. Okay, everyone. Thank you, Vice Mayor Story, for taking over for that time. That was a little rocky. I had to restart the computer and do all sorts of things, but we're now going to be moving on to item 2B. This is a presentation regarding the Cabrillo College Local Government Fellows Program. Who will I be turning this over to this evening? Arnie?
Arnie, yes.
Welcome.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Good, wonderful. Wonderful. Good evening, Mayor Brooks and members of the Capitola City Council. Thank you so much for making time for us on your agenda tonight. I'm Arnie Croce, and with me here tonight are Dale Ellen, Eileen Hill, and Matt Rickstein. And we're here to express our gratitude to the Capitola City Council for the very generous contribution you made to the Cabrillo College Local Government Fellows Program. This is special significance to me. Cabrillo College is the most significant institution in my life. My father died unexpectedly when I was a freshman in high school, and I very quickly picked up some bad habits and neglected school, and by the time I graduated with my 2.0 GPA, there were few options available for me, and kind of by default, I enrolled at Cabrillo. And the staff, the faculty, Cabrillo were all outstanding. They were supportive. They were stimulating. They made me want to learn, and I did very well. And that led to transfer to UC Berkeley to a degree in political science, ultimately a master's in public administration, and a 30-plus year career in city management, including 18 years as a city manager in the city of San Mateo. And my wife and I recently returned to Santa Cruz, and I wanted to initiate a program that would recognize the impact that Cabrillo had on my life, and also begin to train the next generation of local government leaders. You are all local government leaders. You know the important role that local government plays in the lives of our communities. And we can't play those roles. Roles without dedicated, competent public leaders. And the best way to do that, to begin that, is to spark interest among students in local government careers. And that's what this program is intended to do. We've got some pretty significant competition out there in engaging students. There's a shiny object with finance and tech. And that's why a group of current and former local government officials came together to develop the Cabrillo College Local Government Fellows Program. And I'm going to turn it over to Gail Kellerman, who I'm sure is well known to all of you, to tell you a little bit more about the program. But, thank you very much, and we appreciate the generous contribution and the time to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Arnie. Hi, my name is Gail Kellerman. Spent 27 and a half years working for the county, and an additional 8 working for the state legislature. I'm a huge fan of Cabrillo College. My son attended the Cabrillo College before getting into UCLA to finish his degree in linguistics and computer science. And like Councilmember Peterson, who recommended that the city of Capitola dedicate grant funds to the Cabrillo College Local Government Fellows Program, I am passionate about getting more young adults involved in government. The Local Government Fellows Scholarship Program will provide support for students to pursue an education that can lead to a career in local government. There will be an emphasis on first-generation students. So the program includes a $2,000 scholarship, a paid internship with local government agencies, and thank you to our local city managers and county administrative officer who have agreed to make this possible. And we're also going to be providing mentoring by a current or retired government leader. We've set a very ambitious goal of raising a permanent endowment of $100,000, and this will support two fellows annually in perpetuity. So the Capitola City Council's $10,000 contribution brings us to $33,000, which is one-third of our goal. So, wow, thank you so much for doing that. We hope your actions will spur the other cities and the county to consider a similar contribution. Thank you for your financial support and commitment to developing the next generation of local government leaders. And I'm going to ask Eileen Hill to provide details on how people can get involved.
Okay, so I just want to say my name is Eileen Hill. I'm the executive director of the Cabrillo College Foundation, and say thank you to all of you for making this possible. This was a huge gift to really help us get our towards our goal and really make an impact here. I want to thank Gail and Army, as well as Dan McCray and Jamie, who have helped us get this started and going. There's a number of individuals who have made this possible, and we're really hoping that this spring we'll be able to make the first award to a deserving student, a future leader, and as council member Kristen Pearson said, somebody who wants to do something. And I think that was really powerful, and I think that's what we're hoping we can do with the scholarship. So thank you all so much again. If you know of any groups who want to learn more about what we're doing or how they can get involved, they can contact me at the Cabrillo College Foundation. If you want to make a donation, you can go to foundation.cabrillo.edu and donate and put in the notes that it is to the local fellows government scholarship. And I'll hand it over to Matt Wechsteiner, Cabrillo College president.
Thank you, Eileen. Thank you, Arnie and Gail. I just want to extend my appreciation to the council members, to Mayor Brooks, for the progressive, forward-thinking spirit that you're bringing to this scholarship program. I benefited when I was a young college student in many, many same ways as Arnie did. I was able to do an internship in Washington and get involved in local government, or excuse me, in federal government, maybe in the same way that Gail was. And it changed my life. It sent me on a course to study political science as a master's and PhD program. I happened to go through a program at Northern Illinois that trained most of the city managers in Northern Illinois, north of Springfield. So this is so personal to me in the sense that I know so many of my colleagues that went through graduate studies who are doing the kind of work that you all do on a daily basis. It is so important to support our students, and they're so deserving. As first-gen students, I'm just delighted with the generosity that you've shown. And on behalf of the college, the foundation, everyone here, I just want to say thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Matt. And thank you to all of you for putting this wonderful program together. I actually wanted to acknowledge Councilmember Peterson. She was the council member who initiated this and brought this forward to council. And so we are so lucky to have her and bringing this to Capitol and to our attention. So thank you, Councilmember Peterson, for this. If we don't know, do we have any questions for our guests this evening before we move on? Councilmember Peterson?
Thank you so much. I don't have any questions. Like, I just want to make a quick comment and say thank you. I'm so excited about this program, and I want to thank you all so much for the time and effort that you've put into making it a thing. And I know our city manager was involved as well, so thank you to Jamie. Much as Arnie said, you know, I tested out of high school when I was 16. I went into community college and finished when I was 18. And then I didn't go back for a bachelor's until I was 24. And at that time, I didn't have the credits I needed. So I went to Cabrillo. And that's when I first got involved in my political science classes and realized that this is a thing I wanted to be a part of. And I wish that when I was younger, someone had told me that all the good trouble I was getting into was actually activism. And these are things that you can change through politics and through government. And I learned a lot of that at Cabrillo, and then went on to CSUMB, where through my service learning program, I interned with Sam Barr's office, and later went to Cal State Northridge for my master's in public administration. And so all of this started with Cabrillo. All of this started with a program like this that showed someone that they could be involved in something bigger than themselves. And so I'm just so very excited. And again, thank you all for the time and effort that you put into this. I can't wait to see the next generation of local leaders that come out of this program. Thank you.
Thank you, Council Member. Council Member Bertrand.
So I was just wondering, are you going to be cooperating with the Panetta Institute, because that's part of their mission, is to get young students involved in government?
Yeah, really quickly, great question. We often will get requests from Secretary Panetta to have students attend, especially the speaker series that goes on every year through the spring semester. And we have in the past had two or three students who were able to get a ticket to those events, which is just a terrific opportunity for them to have a day to network down in Monterey. With the secretary and the folks involved, and it's a spark plug for them. It really lights a torch for some of those students. And so the quick answer is absolutely any kind of outreach we can do in that effort, we will do.
Yeah, because I know they have an internship program, but it's on the federal level. So it sounds like you're well acquainted with them. That's great.
Okay. Well, thanks again, everyone. Nice to see all of you. And I look forward to hearing more about how this is going to grow and develop really soon. I look forward to it. Okay, we're now going to move on to item 3 for additional materials. Do we have any additional materials for tonight's agenda?
Yes, yes, Mayor Brooks, there is one for item 8A, which is the temporary outdoor dining update. And there were 5 items for 8C, which is the side letters for the existing MOUs.
Okay, great.
Mm-hmm.
And then any for item 4,
additions
and deletions?
Staff, has no
changes. Okay, so we'll move on to item 5 for oral communications. This allows time for members of the public to address the City Council on any consent item on tonight's agenda or any other topic within the jurisdiction of the city that is not on our general government or public hearing section of the agenda. Do we have any from our audience this evening?
Mayor Brooks, I do not see anyone asking to speak, and I do not see any emails for public comment or communications.
Okay, great. And so then we'll move on to item 6. This is the staff and city council comments, and we'll begin with staff.
Mayor Brooks, I just have one short announcement to make tonight. As council will know, you budgeted funding for implicit bias training for staff. We had that scheduled to take place later this month. Unfortunately, due to staffing shortages, the trainers have had to cancel that date. We are now looking at dates, I think December 15th and January 26th to get that done. So I know that the goal was to get it done this calendar year, but it looks like it's going to have to push into next year.
Thank you, Jamie. Any other staff comments? Okay, we'll move this to council. Any council comments? Okay, seeing none, we'll move on to item 7. This is consent. All items listed on consent will be enacted by one motion in the form listed below. There will be no separate discussion on these items prior to the time the council votes on the action, unless a member of the council would like to request a specific item be discussed for separate review. Seeing none, that if no one wants to pull an item, I'll see if anyone would like to entertain a motion.
I move the consent calendar.
Okay, we have a first from Council Member Bertrand and a second from Council Member Peterson. May I have a roll call, please?
Council Member Bertrand.
I approve.
Council Member Kaiser.
Aye.
Council Member Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
This item passes unanimously. We'll now move to item 8A. This is to receive the status report on our temporary program. And I believe this is Mr. Jeffberg, your item.
Good evening, Mayor and Council.
And Council, Mr. Jeffberg, 1 second. Councilmember Heiser.
I'm so sorry, guys. I, due to my employment at Paradise Beach Grill, I have a financial conflict with the outdoor dining, so I will recuse myself. Thank you.
Okay, back to you, Steve.
Hopefully you can see that. The item before you tonight is just a status report of the temporary outdoor dining program that's currently in place in the village area. Quick background, on August 26th of this year, the council extended the temporary outdoor dining program to January 3rd, 2022, due to ongoing concerns about the pandemic. At that time, new maintenance requirements were established that all trash must be picked up, flower boxes and planters must contain healthy vegetation, and the equipment and structures must be clean and all operational. And the storage of other materials in the area is probably what we're after there. The council at that time asked for staff to monitor the outdoor dining areas and for compliance and noise and usage, and calls for police. So this is that report coming back to you tonight. First, we'll talk about compliance with the new rate maintenance requirements. Shortly after the August council meeting, we sent a letter to all the current users of the outdoor dining program, advising them of the new rules. Particularly, the biggest thing was probably getting rid of the dead vegetation in their planters and keeping it looking lively. All the users did come into compliance relatively quickly. I think we've had one follow-up letter for somebody to replace the plants, but compliance has been good since that time. I'll add at this time that we did have a new user join us on the Esplanade who had been there previously during the summer, but when we removed some spots on the Esplanade they wanted out, they decided they did want to try and do it. When we approved that, we did make sure that they are aware of the existing deadline of January 2022 to come out, and that they need to meet all the new requirements. They have done that. I think they went in at the end of October, and so far they're doing a good job of maintaining their spot. Regarding noise, the police department worked with all the current users. The biggest issue they had was was the playing of music, both in the outdoor dining area and also broadcasting from their building toward the outdoor dining area. They were informed that the broadcasting music and playing music in the outdoor dining area wasn't permitted, and they have all stopped doing that. The police department is doing regular checks in the evening to make sure that compliance maintained. And then regarding calls of service, the police department didn't identify any direct calls because of problems related to the outdoor dining areas. I think there was over 600 calls or something at that time, and so it's hard to really tie down exactly what each call was for. If the council is interested, they can create a little subcode to attach to all the codes, so that if it does have any tie to outdoor dining, they would do it. But at this point, the police was pretty confident that there was no call service due to the outdoor dining areas. Then on usage, I just have to start. We'll expand from the one that is in the agenda pack tonight. I wanted to try and gather some more data, and I think I collected a little more data on them. So this bid report shows, I broke it down by street. So when we started on the top here, we have Esplanade. We have 5 users currently there. We counted users there over 7 different times. Once we tried to hit in the afternoons and one around before sunset. So on the Esplanade, we had, in those 7 times, we had a total of 12 diners, and they take up 18 parking spaces along the Esplanade. So they kind of have a usage of 0.67 diners per parking space. It's just a way to rate it. On Monterey, we actually have 1 user on the street and 1 user in Long Way. I removed the Long Way, so we're just looking at the dining on the street in this chart. They have 16 diners when the inspection went on, I drove through. They have 5 spaces, so they have a use of 3.2 users per space. You can see Capitol Avenue is one restaurant. They had a usage of 3. And then along San Jose Avenue, where we have 3 users, they had a usage of 3.4. That's just a way to compare the two. Not significant, but you can see that the Esplanade that uses the largest areas has the least usage. The other two are all pretty consistent, right around 3 users per space. So now I'd like to just briefly mention the Planning Commission and the kind of the permanent program ordinance that's coming forward. The first reading of the permanent program ordinance, which Community Development Director Hurley has been working on for quite a while, is scheduled to come to your next meeting on November 23rd. The Planning Commission reviewed it last week, and we'll be sending comments along with that. And part of their comments was they recommended that the temporary program be continued until the summer, spring or summer of next year, until the permanent program is fully developed. Timing for the permanent program, as you know, depending on if we get the ordinance adopted. Once the City Council has done the second hearing on the adoption of the ordinance, it will need to go to the Planning or to the Coastal Commission for certification. At this time, if we continue on the path, the shortest path we can do, we will have a permanent program in May. Delaying it while we wait for the development of a prototype parklet, if we will, would probably delay it until after the summer of next year. So the actions tonight, this is the conclusion of my report, but that tonight's council is receiving this update, and there's no action necessary. Without any action, the program will continue to be ending on January 3rd, 2022. If you want to provide us direction to make changes to the program, we can't do that tonight, but we would recommend that you give us that direction tonight, and we would schedule that on the December 9th City Council meeting. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thanks so much. And just for clarification, this is just a presentation that does not require any action, and the PC recommendations will be presented again at our next meeting, right?
It was just a little
taste of what they did. Okay, great. Council Member Bertrand.
Yeah, Steve, I read your report, and your observation sort of dovetailed with mine in the fact that during the week, especially along the Esplanade, there's not much usage. So I was just wondering if you could comment on that, because you've probably seen more examples of that than I have.
Right. As I did my survey, I tried to pick different times, different days of the week. And as the data showed that I put up, the Esplanade area has by far the lowest usage. I think they had 2 users there while I was visiting. Granted, I didn't do any morning runs. They had no usage in any of the 7 times I visited the village. All the other areas seem to have, you know, some usage most of the time in the afternoons and the evenings. I did not go when it was raining.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't expect you to do that. So my other question is, so I appreciate your trying to get a sense of the usage. And Esplanade doesn't get at least percentage uses like San Jose, for instance. And I think there's some early comments when the restaurant owners were talked to that a lot of them didn't want to even take advantage of the surface on the street because they couldn't either handle it in their kitchen, or they had balconies that faced the river and stuff like that. Is this sort of still the situation, or I'm just trying to understand, because we're taking up parking space that, you know, obviously people want, and if we're not getting good use out of that, that's my concern. So I'm just trying to better understand the data from your perspective.
As we headed into the summer, the larger restaurants on the Esplanade chose to, get rid of their outdoor dining program that they had used during the pandemic, that they were able to use their existing facilities, and they were having trouble when their existing facilities were full and the outdoor dining was full, keeping up the tours. I can't speak for all the restaurants, these are 2 of the several along the Esplanade that I heard that story from. As we move forward, you know, I think the regulations are now that they have complete use of their indoor dining facilities. Some of them do have outdoors along this one, have outdoor along the street that they're able to use. So there's no limitations is what we had before. And I think especially this time of year, the demand out there, unless it's a hot weekend day, they're able to actually serve their clientele with their in, with their facilities indoors or on their back decks.
Councilmember Bertrand, you're muted.
Oh, yeah. I'm trying to understand the perspective of the restaurants and the users of the parklet. And there was a comment in one of the letters about, you know, the difficulty, even if they only used it on the weekend, then the difficulty of storing their equipment, their tables and chairs and all that kind of stuff. But in reality, they're not using the space except maybe on the weekend. Any comments about that that better help me?
I mean, certainly weekend uses are higher, so it's more crowded on the weekend. That just follows as long as we have nice weather. And there is no other place to, they can't disassemble the parklet and reassemble it just for weekends, so that certainly doesn't work. So their options are, if they want to use it on the weekends, is to just keep it clean and probably have it take up the parking spaces in a week, and that's what we need to decide if that's what we want for the village.
Any other questions from council? Okay, so we'll go ahead and open this up to public comment. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us. Or to speak, clicking on reactions, then clicking a raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing *9 on your landline mobile phone. Our moderator will unmute you and you'll have up to 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor Brooks, I don't see anyone attendees wishing to speak. However, I do have a few emails on this topic. Unfortunately, it's been a little while since I've done this, so a little patience on this. So the first one I'm going to share.
Larry, do you want to just read them too?
They're pretty long.
Okay.
Some of them, so I prefer to have the. It read, but we'll try. I'll try the first one if that's okay. If that doesn't work, then I can try my
best. Perfect. Perfect.
So I hope you see the screen okay. And I will try the.
Thank you, Honorable City Council and members of the Planning Department, in working with the hardest hit economic sector of our city, the service industry. Right to the point. Please understand the service industry has been the hardest hit economic sector across the U.S. Besides the obvious cash flow concerns caused by COVID, the service industry is suffering an unprecedented lack of employees, making sales hard to attain. The service industry is in a recovery mode. We have a lot to make up for to survive. This is where we still need the city's help. The outdoor dining is key to that recovery. That is why the governor passed SB 314. This recovery bill gives outdoor dining and to-go alcohol an extended period, 2024, with no additional fees and more flexibility in outdoor dining areas. This bill was recently passed so the service industry can have the needed time to recover. In the spirit of SB 314, Capitola's best action at this time is almost none at all. We urge you to extend the emergency outdoor dining order to align with the bill recently passed. This will enable the planning department the needed time to develop an outdoor dining program that would be well thought out and not rushed. A plan that we all can be proud of, a plan that will last for decades to come. It was understandable the city's planning department was overwhelmed by the sheer volume of unanswered questions and ideas about this program before them when they last met. On a quick side note, I just want to make sure council and the planning board are reminded that 4 years ago a parklet program was approved by planning, city council, and the coastal commission for my bar on San Jose Ave. Hence, I was disappointed to hear of all the expenses the city is looking to incur now with new prototypes, new blueprints, studies, and more, when much of this has already has been done. We welcome any council member or planner who may not be familiar with that park-led program to reach out to us. We still own the blueprints and would be more than willing to share any information we have to possibly save the city some expenses and slash or time. We read that staff recommends we remove our fixtures and equipment from the outdoor dining for winter. Please do not make us do this. Sometimes the best weather is in winter. If we can fill a few tables on a beautiful January or February day, that helps us recover. Taking it away for winter would be detrimental to our recovery. Understand, having a business remove the outdoor dining would add undue expense of storage, payroll, and even more important, disappointed customers. Please do not make us remove our chance of recovery. Don't make us remove our outdoor dining for winter. Back to the heart of it. Now is not the time to try and reinvent parking, traffic, and pedestrian access in the village. Now especially is not the time to increase operating costs on the hardest hit businesses. Now is the time for recovery. Give us that chance to recover. Follow the example of the state and temporarily keep the emergency order in place with the same timeline as SB 314. And let us keep our welcoming outdoor dining space for all to enjoy, especially on the sunny, beautiful winter days. We urge the council to make a motion to extend the emergency outdoor dining order. Thank you. Doug and Anne-Marie Conrad, owners, Capitola Wine Bar.
Mayor Brooks, I have another email. I'll try and do that again.
Although this agenda item seems to only address an updated report to be submitted, I would like to take this occasion to express my concern over moving forward to approve permanent outdoor dining in the March 2022 timeframe. I'm not sure making this a permanent arrangement is such a good idea until it is vetted more thoroughly and the cost of doing so, $7,000.00/MO, is made to be shared by the restaurant owners that think this is a worthwhile endeavor. What is the rationale to push this permanent approach so quickly? Perhaps you could make clear what the process for approving this approach is and what key gates does it need to pass along with the timeline. Thank you for your time. Send a mail for Windows.
I have another email. Try again.
Dear City of Capitola, I am objecting to a change in the long-standing zoning that exists to protect the residents and visitors of Capitola Village until and unless there is proof of a permanent need for a new use of the public right-of-way for private enterprise. It is unconscionable to have the public and residential uses for long-established needs within the village changed for something that is temporary. Parking, noise, unsafe pedestrian use of the public right-of-way cannot be dismissed through hypotheticals. Unsafe pedestrian use of the public right-of-way cannot be dismissed through hypothetical surveys. We, the citizens of Capitola, ask the city to defend and protect out existing zoning bylaws and not allow them to be corrupted. Thank you. Mary McKittrick.
Okay, I think I have one more email.
Let me introduce myself. I am Eric Bossett, a native Californian and Capitola homeowner. I have lived in my current home on 44th Avenue for 40 years. There are several instances of inaccurate and misrepresented numbers in your reporting and survey of the outdoor dining ordinance used to show support for the outdoor dining. The questions by their nature are unclear and not supported by concrete examples of defined population sets, such as visitors, village residents, or restaurant users. This does not nurture trust in any information the city provides its citizens. The Village Outdoor Dining Survey is a misleading set of figures which cannot be verified with raw data. example being question number 2, shown as a graph. The question itself is biased, and should have been worded, are you concerned about the loss of parking in the village? Yes or no? The numbers then look like this, yes, 46.14%, no, 53.85%, including for a margin of error, as is done in most public surveys, the numbers more honestly would be shown as 50 to 50%. 196 responses does not even amount to 2% of the population of Capitola, 9,938 people by national census. As a citizen of Capitola, I feel the city is moving far too fast to rush making permanent the outdoor dining ordinance. The city appears to be steamrolling over the citizens of Capitola to pass measures without community support. This will result in something that will look like a train wreck for the citizens of our community. I support the idea of helping business during our time of pandemic crises. I feel it is irresponsible to make any permanent changes to temporary measures until this national crisis has passed. Sincerely, Eric Fawcett.
I don't know what's going on here. I'm going to share.
Make it stop!
I'm trying! Here, I'm going to share. I'm
going to comment, public comment.
Okay, all right. Sorry.
Okay.
Always something new in technology. So I believe that is our last email. We do have one attendee with their hand raised to speak on this item.
Okay.
It's Linda Smith.
Okay, I think I'm unmuted now. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
I wasn't going to speak tonight because I know this is not really on your agenda, and November 23rd I will be back. But many of you know me, and many of you know how passionate I am about our outdoor dining. I think you received tonight from Steve a very objective and accurate report of what's going on with the outdoor dining. The reason that I'm going to speak to you is that I attended the Planning Commission meeting, and I am hoping that you will listen to the recommendation when it comes to you on the 23rd and extend the emergency ordinance, which allows what is happening now to continue, because there is a strong leaning in that group to eliminate some of the streets that currently appreciate the outdoor dining. And I know we're going into the winter, and I know it's going to be much less than that, but we need, I believe, to really consider eliminating any streets and picking and choosing who can and who cannot participate in an outdoor dining or a sidewalk dining environment. Because it's my experience after living here for 20 years that the outdoor dining and sidewalk dining that we have allowed during the pandemic has brought a measure of vitality and energy to our community that is goodness. And I would hate to see us eliminate it to the point where the Esplanade, which is not really interested in this vitality, is the only street that's allowed to have it. So I just wanted to voice that, give you some food for thought between now and the 23rd, and I'll talk to you again then. Thank you for listening to me. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Linda. Larry, anyone else?
Hey, Brooks, I do not see anyone else with their hand raised on this item, and we do not have any more emails.
Okay, so we'll bring this back to council. Again, this does not require any action, but if anyone has any final comments before we move on to our next item. Okay, Council Member Bertrand.
Yeah, I talked to a couple of residents that were concerned about noise. And I understand that staff is working to come up with some sample parklets. Are there any considerations in the designs to mitigate noise?
walls, mini town walls or coverings. Some I've seen a lot of parklets that have like whole tents over them. I mean, I have no idea that I'd like that, but I mean, maybe certain designs might help mitigate noise for some of the residents. So that's just my question in terms of the design.
So I can kind of cross-touch to that. We really haven't started the prototype design. We're just getting proposals from two designers at this time. I think they're both due by the end of this week. Certainly, there's going to be some solid walls, but they're all going to be low, 36 to 42 inches. But I think the big thing for as far as noise and, well, music's the big thing. There's no music permitted. But as far as voices and things like that, it's really difficult to, you know, build a sound barrier that is both sightly and something we'd want to do on the street. So there'll be some solid walls. There'll be some probably open fencing that is still part of it. But as far as buffering the noise from voices, that may prove difficult. But we can talk to the architect that we end up selecting along those lines.
Okay. So I see our city man. Vice Mayor Story.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. I just wanted to maybe ask that when this comes back to us on the 23rd, that related to the Planning Commission's recommendation that the temporary program be continued, I would just like to, and if we're going to entertain that idea, that we look at the number of spaces being used right now. It looks like there's 32 parking spaces. And if I recall in a previous council meeting, we said we were going to limit the permanent spaces to 25. So I would like staff just to bring back how we go from 32 to 25, and how that may impact extending the temporary program. And since it does have some financial loss to the city in parking revenue, I think that would certainly be relevant to me. But I hope that staff understands what I'm asking for, whether if we do extend the temporary program, whether that should be extended for 32 or to 25, if that's where we're going to ultimately end up for a permanent program. Thank you.
And I just, Councilmember Bertrand, did you want to add anything before we move on to the next item?
Thank you, Mayor. Since Sam brought up the topic, and I sort of touched on it a little bit, and based on my questioning of Steve, it bothers me that there's so much unused space or periodic use at certain times, and, you know, that's parking revenue, and, you know, if we're going to go to allowing this to happen, then the fees should, you know, reflect that, I think. And, you know, if they only want to use it on the weekend, you know, we need to take that into account. I mean, that's based on their business model, I understand, but I am very concerned about that because parking is at a premium and people that come here expect parking, and if they see these vacant spots with some tables and chairs and stuff that not even being used, I think that sets the wrong image for us. I don't like what you said.
Thank you, Councilmember Bertrand. I'd like to just add a quick comment, Jamie, and then I'll come to you. So for our next meeting when this comes to us, the other piece that's missing from this puzzle is actually hearing from the business owners themselves and their plans. We're kind of seeing these like high level numbers and this kind of these graphs and so forth, and I just think it'd be important just to get a feel for what they really want to do, and if that's asking all of the restaurants on the Esplanade what are their long-term plans, what do they want, and what do the folks folks on the other streets want. I mean, we're only talking about a small number of businesses to give them calls and get a direct response from. I think that would be very helpful because we're kind of doing this, making these decisions after at a high level here, and it would be nice just to hear what they'd like to do as well. Okay, so Jamie, and then we'll move on to the next item.
All right, I just want to try to help everyone focus on the difference between the permanent program, which is going to be an ordinance that the city would adopt, and then this temporary program. So as of right now, the temporary program will end on January 3rd, unless the council member tells us that they would like to see this on an agenda before that happens. So I want to be really clear. Be clear about that, because I think when we start talking about the two programs together, it gets really confusing for some people. So the next hearing we have planned is about the long-term program that we've been discussing, because we tend to merge these two topics, but that is the next planned hearing, to talk about the long-term ordinance that we would be putting in place that would hopefully take effect before next summer and would then be in place the law of the land for the city for a while to come. So I just want to make sure we're all on the same page.
And Jamie, to that point, though, I want to be sure, though, that council has to their discretion to pause that conversation and to just extend the emergency ordinance to fall in line with the SB, I forget the number, the rule at our next meeting. So if we wanted, after we got this information, that, you know what, there's not enough time or not enough information to continue on with this bigger long-term permanent project, we could extend in the meantime. We have that at our discretion at the next meeting. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was asking, because right now there wasn't a plan to bring it back, but I'm hearing you say that council does want to see that again, so we will make sure that's on the agenda for our next meeting.
Well, I just want it to be an option. So like you said, it's twofold here. So if this is something we want to do, and to Vice Mayor Story's point of, you know, what would 25 look like if we were just to extend the emergency ordinance rather than what the 25 would look like for the permanent program. So I'd like you to see that too, Vice Mayor Story, but I don't know if that was what you were alluding to as well.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm alluding to. I mean, if we're going to be extending the temporary program, are we extending that for all current 32 spaces being used, or just for 25? Or and so, yeah, but just to, if I may respond to Jamie's statement about the order of our business, I thought we were considering the Planning Commission's recommendations on November the 23rd, and one of those recommendations was to extend the temporary program. So doesn't that make it part of the November 23rd agenda item?
So the planning, we brought forward the Planning Commission's recommendation around the temporary program, because that's what this agenda item tonight is. And then they have recommendations about the permanent program, and those will be conveyed to you on the 23rd as well. But I mean, I think if the council would like to talk about the temporary program and the permanent program on the 23rd, we can do that. That's what I'm hearing the council, at least a couple council members say this evening. So we can do that.
Well, good. Thank you. Yeah, I think that we should try to tackle that issue on the 23rd, so everybody knows to know what the plan for come January. Thank you.
Okay, Jamie, do you know what you need?
We do. Thank you.
All right, so let's move on to 8B, our special events, highlights, and issues for 2021. Captain Daly?
Hi, good evening.
This is your item.
All right.
Congratulations again.
Great, thank you. I'm going to make my first attempt at sharing my screen. Can you see me? Can you see my screen?
I do not see your screen, but I can hear it. Councilmember Kaiser has returned just for Chloe to know.
Thank you, Mayor.
And can you see my screen now or no?
No.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, I'll just go with it here.
Captain
Callie, would you like me to share it? Is it on the shared section?
It's on my desktop. So
okay.
This is a short item here. So tonight we're here to review the 2021 special events. And with that, we're going to see if there's any issues that we identify. We can determine if there's additional review that needs to happen, and then we'll examine if we want to extend the reoccurring events for 2022. And so with that, a little bit of background is that we have two different special events. There's general events, and then we also have minor events. Typically, a general event is those events that are 200 people or more, and then they also have significant impact to city services. Those events are like our car show, the Work to Work, Heart and Wine Beach Festival, and the fireworks. And then our minor events are those events that are a little bit smaller. And it's typically those events with attendees of 200 and less, with no significant impact to the city services. Events like that are like Operation Surf, the citizen strolls, and the food truck events that we have throughout the city. Last year was a little bit of a different year, obviously with the pandemic. In a typical year, we issue about 10 general permits per year and about 36 minor permits. In 2021, we only issued 5 general permits, and those permits were actually Operation Surf, which is in the beginning of the year. And then we had the Art and Wine, the Beach Festival, and then the Women on Waves event, and the Fireworks event. So those are the 5 events that we had. And then we only had 4 minor events. It was definitely a late start, but besides those 4 minor events, we were also able to add some Twilight concerts, movies at the beach, and then Sunday art at the beach. Throughout all the limited events, just due to the pandemic, we did not have any significant issues that were raised for the 2021. And moving forward, all the events with organizers from the previous years that might move forward with the special events for 2022, and those events are all identified in the packet. And so the recommended action tonight would be to provide any direction regarding any specific changes that you have, determine if there's any additional review that needs to be required for any of the special events, and then if not, authorize staff to treat last year's events or the events that are in your packet as reoccurring new initiative permits for this coming year. And with that, I can take any questions.
Okay, council members, any questions for Captain Daly? Oh my God, I keep saying Captain. I mean Chief Daly. I'm so sorry.
Not till Sunday.
Okay.
You're fine.
Okay. Vice Mayor Story.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. I think my question is not lost what my question is, but I'll be premature, Chief Daly, but what I wanted to ask is looking over the list of events from last year. There's an event that we just had this last week put on by the Capitol Art and Cultural Commission, the Plein Air Art Project. And I just noticed it's not on the list, but maybe they don't get a permit or aren't required to have a permit. And if they are, maybe I would like to ask that event be listed as reoccurring.
Sure. It's my understanding we don't issue them a permit for as a special event because it doesn't have significant impact and the attendees is just small. So we don't issue a permit at this point.
Okay. So they won't be jeopardized in any way next year when it comes around. Okay. Good. Thank you.
Councilmember Peterson.
Thank you, and forgive me, perhaps this is something I should already know, but I also don't see the BIA has done a cookie walk in previous years. Is that something that we give them a permit for, or is that also something that doesn't require a permit?
We've never issued a permit for the cookie walk, so I would imagine it's one of those that fall under the permit requirements. But if it did, it would only be a minor, you know, if it became, and then, like I said, it wouldn't rise to the level even to council at that point. So there's still some layers that have to get to rise to this level.
Okay, so it's based on the packet, it looks like you're just looking for us to authorize these ones as recurring, and then if any other minor event permit comes, then you'll just authorize those as a staff. Okay, perfect. Thank you.
Any other questions from council? Andy, is this the extent of it? If there were to be another larger event, it would come back to council. Is that correct?
Correct. So any new general event, a large event would come before council.
Okay, great. I just want to make sure that there's just opportunity for that, just in case we've missed one or something comes forward. Okay, so let's bring this to open this for public comment. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us. Or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions and clicking the raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing *9 on your landline mobile phone. Our moderator will unmute you and you'll have up to 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees wishing to speak on this item, and I do not see any emails on this item.
Okay, let's bring this back to council for a vote.
I'll move to accept the report.
I can second that.
So we have a first to approve the reoccurring special event permit conditions as presented by Andy this evening, and we have a second from Councilmember Kaiser. May I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I approve.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, this item passes unanimously. We're now going to move on to item C, consider the approval of side letter to existing memorandum understanding with employee groups regarding vacation cash out provisions. And I'd like to say a quick few words as required by state law prior to making changes in compensation for at-will employees. As mayor, I need to read the following statement. At-will management employees consist of department heads and the city manager. Before the city council this evening, as part of agenda item 8C, is a recommendation for changes to employee agreements, including the management compensation plan and city manager employment contract. The proposed changes to the agreements include a one-time vacation cash out in 2021, a vacation leave accrual for employees over the amount in the existing contract. So with that, I could turn this over to staff.
Hello, Mayor Brooks, Councilor. Let me share my screen really quickly. Hold on, maybe not really quickly. Share screen. No audio, good. Okay, can you see my screen okay?
Yes.
Okay, great. So before you have item 8C, city and employee groups came to agreement on a one-time change to the mandatory cash out provision in agreements. The groups that agreed to this were the Capitol Police Health Association, confidential employees, mid-management employees, not just one employee, management employees, and the city manager. We are still in discussions with the Association of Capitola Employees on this item. City groups and groups negotiated the suspension of the May 2021 mandatory cash out. That had been part of all the agreements, but due to COVID and the uncertainty of the cash flow situation, this was done last December. This was suspended for 2021. Unfortunately, it created a situation where some employees' vacation balances would end up being significantly higher This one-time proposed cash-out will occur in December of 2021 for those above the limits. The goal of this is to, by the next mandatory cash-out, which is in the agreement for May of 2022, everyone would be back down to the limits that are defined in the contract. In addition, the Capitol Police Association does not have an optional cash-out, and because overall the accrual leaves have gotten much higher during the pandemic due to a number of circumstances, the proposal includes a one-time 40-hour cash-out for all employees in the group, not just those that are above the limits. So the recommendation tonight is to authorize the city manager to execute side letter agreements for the following groups: the Capitol Police Officers Association, mid-management employees, confidential employees, and approve changes to the management compensation plan and to the city manager employee contract. And with that, I'm here to answer any questions.
Thank you, Larry. Council, do we have any questions? Okay, seeing none, we're going to go ahead and open this to public comment. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomments@ci.capitola.ca.us, or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions, then clicking raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing star 9 on your landline mobile phone. Our moderator will unmute you and you'll have up to 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees looking to speak on this item, and we do not have any emails on
this item. Okay, so we'll bring this back to council for a vote. Now, council members, this evening, if you are going to be making a motion, we're going to need to take these items separately. So the first item on tonight's agenda is item C1, and that authorizes the city manager to execute the side letter agreements to existing memoranda of understanding MOU with changes to A, the Capitol Police Officers Association, B, mid-management employee bargaining unit, and C, confidential employee bargaining unit.
I would like to make a motion for C1.
Okay. We have a first from Council Member Kaiser and a second from Council Member Peterson. May I have a roll call, please?
Council Member Bertrand.
I agree.
Council Member Kaiser.
Aye.
Council Member Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye. Okay, we'll bring this back to Council for item C2. This is to approve changes to the management compensation plan.
Move approval of item 8C2.
Okay.
We have a first from Council Members Peterson and a second from Vice Mayor Story. May I have a roll call, please?
Council Member Bertrand.
I agree.
Council Member Kaiser.
Aye.
Council Member Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Right, and lastly, aye. That's me.
Thank you.
And then lastly, C3, approved changes to city manager employee contract.
I can also make a motion for item C3, approved changes to city manager employee contract.
The first from Council Member Kaiser.
I'll second.
And a second from Vice Mayor Story. May I have a roll call, please?
Council Member Bertrand.
I agree.
Council Member Kaiser.
Aye.
Council Member Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. That item passes. Thank you, Council. We're going to now move to item D. This is City Council memberships for the 21-22 fiscal year. Jim?
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Give me one moment to share my screen. Can everyone see that okay? All right. So as the Mayor just mentioned, this is regarding City Council memberships for the current fiscal year 21-22.
As you recall, when the pandemic hit, we were preparing our budget for fiscal year 2021. We reduced the city council training and membership budget from a little over 35,000 to just below 20,000. This eliminated memberships to the Monterey Bay Economic Project, which was 5,000. We have been a member since fiscal year 15-16. It also eliminated the city, our membership to the City's Association of St. Clara County, which was 3,000. And this one, we participated in it. Jet and Wave, kind of an ad hoc committee of this association. And we had been a member since fiscal year 18-19. I do want to point out this membership is kind of the timing coincided with COVID, but our discontinuing the membership was unrelated to the pandemic. And we also eliminated all non-essential travel from in all areas of the budget, but including the city council budget, which reduced the training budget from 10,000 down to 2,500. For this fiscal year, 21-22, we kept that budget at the same 19,800. And the budget, that amount includes 2,500 for city council training, 10,900 for our memberships in AMBAG and LAFCO, which are both legally required that we participate or are members of those organizations, and also 6,400 for the League of California Cities, which, as you're all well aware, advocates for city interests, which was especially important during the pandemic. Just to give you a little background on the memberships we cut out, the Monterey Bay Economic Project, which was founded in 2015, is a nonprofit organization consisting of public and private entities in Santa Cruz, Monterey, and San Benito counties, and their mission is to improve the economic health and quality of life in the region. The City's Association of Santa Clara County is a public sector partnership of cities in Santa Clara County, and they formed a Jet Noise Impact Committee and invited cities from within Santa Cruz County to participate, along with Capitola, the City of Santa Cruz, Scotts Valley, as well as Santa Cruz County, all participated in the Jet Noise Impact Committee. Our representative to the Jet Noise Committee recommended discontinuing our membership right towards the end of 2019 and beginning of 2020. And just as a kind of FYI, the City of Santa Cruz, Scott Valley, as well as the county have all discontinued their memberships as well. As a reminder, our fiscal year 21-22 anticipated ending general fund balance is at $750,000. And really, we're looking at the memberships into Monterey Bay Economic Project and or the City's Association of Santa Clara County, kind of considering them as one-time expenses, because we can discontinue these memberships at any time. Once we commit, we're not committing in perpetuity. We can stop at any time. Staff does anticipate presenting the fiscal year 21-22 mid-year budget report at the end of January. And at that time, we kind of give an overall summary of the current year budget picture, and then, if necessary, make any recommended budget adjustments. Our fiscal impact from this item will be dependent upon what City Council's direction is to staff. And with that, our recommended action is to provide direction to staff regarding potential changes in city memberships to local and regional groups. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you so much, Jim. Any questions from council? Nice Mayor Story.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. I was just wanted to ask maybe if the city manager could give us a recommendation concerning renewing our membership in the Monterey Bay Economic Partnership. I believe that Jamie, you attended those conferences or meetings on our behalf. So I was just wondering if you had any insights on whether it's a worthwhile endeavor.
I certainly could chime in, but I know that Mayor Brooks has actually been working with MBAP pretty closely on a couple of different projects. So, Mayor Brooks, do you want to talk a little bit about your experience working with them?
Yeah, I'd be more than happy to. So for the past year, I have reached out to MBAP for support in learning more about affordable housing and workforce housing for our mall project on 41st Avenue. I also tapped into their resources when we were looking at our zoning and most recently our IHO ordinance. We've utilized their white paper that they created a few years ago in for deciding on our most recent zoning code updates, and they have continued to support and are continuing to support us in creating a white paper for workforce housing that we should be seeing by the end of this year. They've just really been an asset to me, and I think overall to the city of Capitola in providing these really high quality, well researched information for us. They have exceptional resources above and beyond the county, and they've been just really helping me out with a lot of stuff. Councilmember Kaiser?
Thanks, Mayor. I just want a little bit of clarification. So becoming a member, is this essentially we just went through all of our grants, right? And using grant money for those that have filled out applications to apply. And so is this similar, or is this just us to be part of something? I'm a little unclear as to why we would like jump into a membership situation when it could have been maybe granted via a grant.
So my understanding of how EdUp works is that they do try to get public agencies to join, and then what they do is if you're a public agency, I think you can get a discount on their State of the Economy conference that takes place down in Monterey once a year. In addition, they have specific task forces that try to work on different issues, from farm worker housing to economic development issues. And so by being a member, you can participate in their different task forces. So I think basically just as a nonprofit, they have a little bit of a different structure. They're not asking for grant funding, they're kind of offering a membership. But I think your point is a decent one for sure.
Any other questions? Okay, so let's move this to public comments. If you'd like to make a comment, send an email now to publiccomment@ci.capitola.ca.us, or to speak, please raise your hand now by clicking on reactions, by clicking raise hand in your Zoom application, or by dialing *9 on your landline mobile phone. Our moderator will unmute you, and you'll have up to 3 minutes to speak.
Mayor Brooks, I do not see any attendees wishing to speak on this item, and we do not have any emails on this item.
Okay, so we'll bring this back to council for further comments and a vote. Councilmember Peterson and Vice Mayor Story, and then Councilmember Bertrand.
Thank you. I first want to speak in support of continuing or re-upping our membership with MBEF. I think that's a great organization. In my day job, I work with a similar organization in Silicon Valley, but I think this one is much more appropriate for us on the Central Coast in the Monterey Bay. I also want to kind of gauge the council's thoughts on adding a new membership to the National League of Cities. We are currently part of the California League of Cities. The National League of Cities for a city of our size would be about $1,500 in membership dues a year. So I'm only suggesting that we do it for a year. If it turns out it's not worth it, none of us take advantage of the opportunities or the networking, the education, the different councils they offer, then we don't do it again. But in looking at the National League of Cities, for example, they have a small cities council, which allows those with 50,000 people or less in their city to come together and discuss issues that are pertinent to smaller cities. I think that's really important, especially considering that throughout the pandemic, we saw with, was it the Build Back Better? No, it was one of the federal bills, the amount of funding that was given to cities with less than 50,000 people was a different kind of funding allocation than it was for the larger cities. And so I feel like being involved with this kind of group would really be helpful.
There's also councils on youth education and family, which I know Mayor Brooks are really interested in. There's a young municipal leaders program, which is really in alignment with what we've just supported with our Cabrillo College, our funding towards Cabrillo College and young municipal leaders. So I've been interested previously in attending some of the National League of Cities conferences, but because we weren't a member, it would have been kind of not worth the cost to pay the non-member cost to join these kind of conferences. But I think that there's a lot to be gained from being a part of a League of Cities that isn't just within our own state, because I've found a lot of benefit from the California League of Cities, and I think that we could find additional benefit from learning from other cities that are outside of California as well, kind of best practices and things of the like. So I'm interested in hearing what the other council members feel about kind of doing a one-year trial of a membership with the National League of Cities. Thank you.
Vice Mayor Story.
Thank you, Mayor Brooks. In order to move this forward, I'd like to maybe put a motion on the table, one that we approve renewing our membership with the Monterey Bay Economic Partnership, and that we also sign on to a membership with the National League of Cities. And that's my motion.
We have a first from Vice Mayor Story and a second from Councilmember Peterson. Councilmember Trent?
No, I think a lot of the words have been taken out of my mind. I don't need to say anything more.
Okay. All right. Any other further comments? Okay. May I have a roll? So the motion on the table is to enter or to become members with MBAP, the Monterey Bay Economic Partnership, and the National League of Cities for a year. May I have a roll call, please?
Councilmember Bertrand.
I agree.
Councilmember Kaiser.
Aye.
Councilmember Peterson.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Story.
Aye.
Mayor Brooks.
Aye.
Thank you.
This item passes unanimously. We're now on to item 9, everyone's favorite, adjournment. Thank you everyone so much. Welcome back, Samantha. Congratulations to our chief once again. Thank you to staff. And tomorrow, I didn't have a moment to recognize it earlier in our agenda, but tomorrow is a day of appreciating and recognizing all of our veterans and for their time and their service to our country. So please take a moment tomorrow if you see someone to say thank you for their service. Have a great evening. Good night.